Good morning, and welcome to Lisbon Falls Baptist Church Online. I'm Matt DeGroft, and I'm here with Pastor Rodrigo, and we are so thrilled that you've chosen to join in with us this morning in worship. We're going to start off with three songs. The first song is, I Will Sing of My Redeemer. So our next song is going to be Come Thou Fount of Every Blessing.
Come Thou Fount of Every Blessing, to my heart to sing Thy grace, streams of mercy never ceasing, call for song. God's redeeming love. good grace. Jesus bought me when a stranger, wandering from the fold of God. He to rescue me from danger, bought me with his precious blood. Oh, to grace, how great a debtor, daily I'm constrained to be. Let thy goodness, like a fetter, bind my wandering heart to thee. Prone to wander, Lord, I feel it, prone to leave the God I love. Here's my heart, oh, take and seal it for thy courts above.
Our last song today is going to be 10,000 Reasons.
Worship his holy name. Sing like never before. Oh, my soul, I'll worship your holy name. The sun comes up, it's a new day dawning. It's time to sing your song. Whatever may pass and whatever lies before me, let me be singing when the evening comes. Bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul, worship his holy. Strength is failing, the end draws near, and my time has come. Still my soul will sing your praise unending. 10,000 years and then
before you today, Lord, just blessing you, praising your holy name, for you alone are worthy. Help us as we go throughout our week to remember that, to keep you number one in our lives, and then to love our neighbor as ourselves. In Jesus' name, amen.
Good morning. Welcome to Lisbon Falls Baptist Church. Great to worship with you. Thank you again to Matt and Pastor Giuliani for the songs we just sang. We praise God, and we praise God for you, that you're here with us today. We're going to be in God's Word in just a moment or so. If you'd like to find it, you can turn in the book of Exodus. So we're going to be with the same guy we were with last Sunday, Joshua, but we're going to move a few years backwards, actually, into Exodus chapter 17. So we'll be with Moses and Joshua in Exodus chapter 17. Now, just a couple of announcements. Those of you that have been with us, you already know kind of the drill, and so we want to encourage you. You know, if God's blessed you and you'd like to give, you can go on tithing and do that, or you can mail your offering here to the church. We want to thank you for your generosity, and God is just using each of you in a great way, and we're just blessed. He's Jehovah Jireh, the provider, and we praise him for that. Also want to remind you, if you're new to kind of the social networking world, Facebook, YouTube, and the like, you'll want to go check out a video that Pastor Giuliani just made for us. And it's on YouTube. It should be on our Lisbon Falls Baptist community page on Facebook, as well as the public page eventually. And it's kind of a tutorial. Actually, it is a tutorial on how you use YouTube, Facebook, how you can help us, how we can get the gospel to more people, and be a blessing to all those folks out there. So just encourage you. It's about 10 minutes, and he just did a great job teaching you some things. Some of you that are pretty techie, you already know that, but the rest of you, it might help you a little bit in just making church as best we can in the times we have in these days of the pandemic. Now, we're going to get to the message of this moment. Today, the message is entitled, The Rod of God. The Rod of God, Exodus chapter 17. We'll have a word of prayer in just a moment. I want to talk to the kids that are with us for just a moment. I want to encourage you kids, mine's got some writing on it, but grab a piece of paper, or if you happen to have a whiteboard or chalkboard or something, but a paper's kind of cool because you can keep it, and you can give it to somebody, your parents, or you could mail it to somebody in the church or a family member or something like that. So today we're going to have a great picture of Moses, and he's going to be literally standing up on a hill on the part of a mountain, actually, and he's going to have the rod of God in his hand. And he's going to have two friends with him, Aaron and Hur. And it just gives us a really neat picture. So as we go through the message today, encourage your kids. I'd love to see some pictures posted on our Facebook page of them, of what they draw from the message. We know the Word of God won't return void. And I want to encourage the children in that way. This is a really good picture, I think, for them to kind of see in their minds and draw. And hey, adults, if you want to get involved, you do that as well. So let's have a word of prayer, and then we're going to jump into Exodus chapter 17. We're going to specifically today look at verses 8 through 16, but we need to do a little background at the beginning part of chapter 17 first. So let's pray, and then we'll jump in. Father, again, thank you for this opportunity. Thank you for the folks that are joining us right now, right here in Lisbon and literally all around the world. Father, again, we thank you for the opportunity that we have to come together. Even though we're separate physically, we can come together spiritually through our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. And we thank you for that. We ask right now that you would open your word, that you would teach us something, and Father, that we would be able to use it in our daily lives. We give you all the praise in Jesus' name. Amen. So who would have thought that even 3 months ago that we would start April in the middle of a pandemic and end April in the middle of a pandemic where we can't even come in here right now and worship together. And so we're going to finish the month the way we started it. I don't know about you. It's been a good month. A lot of lessons God's been teaching me and a lot of things that he's showing me that he's working on in my life. And I'm thankful for that. And I pray the same for you. And so I think this message particularly really meets us where we're at. And this is a message that God's been working on me for about 3 months on. This comes out of my Bible reading, as does the message that we preached last week from the book of Joshua, Be Strong and Courageous. Interestingly enough, it's the same guy. Joshua is in both of these, although today the focus is a little different. Moses is kind of our main character today. But as we come to this passage, I want you to be thinking about the pandemic and some of the things that it has forced each of us to do. In some of our social distancing and not being able to be with each other in the church or with our families or our friends in the ways we normally would. And so I think there's a lot of application here from the scriptures for where we're living today. So if you have your Bibles with you, we're going to read just a couple of verses of the first part of Exodus chapter 17 to a little background. Again, the message is entitled, The Rod of God. The Rod of God. Now, as we read a couple of verses at the very beginning here, one of the things that you're going to need to know, and it's very important, I think, for each of us to understand, is what is Israel learning about this God? Remember, they've come out of Egypt. They've now been out of Egypt for quite some time. But they're moving through this new land, if you will, in a lot of ways, maybe similar to what we're dealing with the pandemic, where this is all new to them, right? They've lived in an area for 430 years, and now they've left, thus the book of Exodus. And so Moses is penning these things as they happen. God's done some incredible miracles for them. He brought them through the Red Sea. He's shown his presence to them in a cloud by day and a pillar of fire by night. At the end of chapter 16, he's finally given them manna, which means, what is it? Which is, it's basically like a honey wafer that God would send them 6 days, and they would gather it, and then they wouldn't eat it. They would eat it on the Sabbath, but they wouldn't work. Eventually down the road, God's going to send them quail as well. And so God provides for them in incredible ways. But now they come up to a couple challenges. And it's amazing how quickly Israel, and to be honest, how about you and me, can forget what great things God has done. And so here's a couple of things that Israel had been learning. There are many more, but just a couple to remind you of. First off, they had learned that ultimately God was a God who remembers his covenants. He does what he says. That God was a God of judgment and deliverance. That he judges sin, but he also delivers those that are repentant or willing to turn from their sin. That God is transcendent yet immanent. Two kind of really big words, right? God is transcendent. What does that mean? God is immanent. Well, the fact that God is transcendent means that God is not trapped by time and space like you and me, right? He can come into time and space, and he did in the form of his Son, the Lord Jesus Christ, but he also exists outside of time and space. But God not only is transcendent, not trapped by time and space, God is also immanent. He's present within the universe he made. Now, God doesn't live in the tree, or he doesn't necessarily live in this building. He lives inside of you and me. But literally, it would be correct to say that literally God is everywhere at once. Now, notice, I didn't say he's in everything, but he's everywhere. And so God is transcendent. God is immanent. And these are things that Israel is learning. They're just about to head to the Ten Commandments. Exodus chapter 20. Not only that, they also learn that God rules the nations and his people, his chosen people, Israel. Israel also learns that God is above all other gods. There's no one like him, and he is holy. He is set apart. He does not sin. And finally, they're learning that God is gracious and merciful. If you want to look that up, you could look in Exodus chapter 32, verses 11 to 14. And so Israel has learned all of these things about God. And they've seen God do incredible things, and yet they're going to forget, maybe a little bit like you and me. So let's look at what the text of Scripture says. Now, the portion we're going to focus on today is Israel's first battle or first war, really, in all the Scriptures, or at least one for a very, very long time. They haven't had anything like this. Probably the last time would have been with Abraham, when Abraham went and fought back in the book of Genesis. But Israel has not fought a war. And they've been going through, God has fought their battles for them. And so God's now provided all these amazing things. He's shown them that he's transcendent, that he's not trapped by time and space, that he's immanent, yet he is present with his people. And now they're going to forget. Look at Exodus 17:1. All the congregation of the people of Israel moved on from the wilderness of Sin by stages, or in other words, kind of in their categories or by their tribes, according to the commandment of the Lord, and camped at Rephidim. But there was no water for the people to drink. Now, this is a desert area, and so water is a very, very hot commodity wherever you are in the world, but especially when you're in a desert area, and especially where Israel's at. And the scripture goes on to say, therefore, the people quarreled with Moses and said, give us water to drink. And Moses said to them, why do you quarrel with me? Why do you test the Lord? And so what we see is Israel has a desire to drink water. There's nothing wrong with that. But ultimately, they weren't trusting God. They were attacking Moses. And the scripture goes on here to say in verse 4 that Moses cries out or prays to the Lord, "What shall I do with this people? They're ready to stone me." So they're so intent on getting water that they're going to kill Moses. Now they've seen up to this point about 15 miracles in the last few chapters. Actually, maybe more like 20 if you count the 10 plagues that God had done, which were still miracles in the land of Egypt. And so now Moses prays to God, and he says, "They're ready to stone me." And the Lord says, "Pass on before the people, taking some of the elders, and take in your hand the staff with which you struck the Nile." And I brought with me my little staff or my rod today. It was a gift from the senior high class here at LFCA back in 2006. And I've kept it all those years. So a few of you that may have been here may have remembered that. So I'm sure it wasn't exactly like this, but it'll give us a little bit of an idea. And so Moses has this. And what the Bible tells us is God says, "Behold, I will stand before you there on the rock at Horeb, and you shall strike the rock, and water shall come out of it, and the people will drink." And so God tells Moses, he does another miracle and has him strike the rock with the rod of God. Now again, the rod represents the presence of God. God has shown his presence in incredible ways. He'd shown it in Egypt. He'd shown it in going through the Red Sea, the cloud by day, the pillar of fire by night, in the wafers they would receive, the manna, the quail. And so God had shown his presence everywhere, but yet, when it came time to drink, Israel kind of forgot that. And so it's interesting because as you come to chapter 17 and the second portion, verses 8 to 16, our main text today, it's important to note what's happened. The children of Israel have really went after God here and Moses. And down in verse 7 it says, "And Moses called the name of that place Massa or Meribah because of the quarreling of the people of Israel and because they tested the Lord by saying, 'Is the Lord among us or not?'" Because up to this point, you may have thought the same thing I did when I read this text. Well, what was wrong with Israel with what they were doing? Friends, they were questioning, does God even care? Does God even exist? Really? After all the things the Lord had done? And yet, you know, if I'm honest and you are, how many times have we done that? How many times, maybe even in this pandemic, or maybe it was last year or last month or a few years ago, that you struggled with something God hadn't done and you'd forgotten the things he had done? Well, that's where Israel's at here. And so that leads us to our text today, the rod of God. And ultimately, first off, we were reminded of the complacency or thankfulness. Ultimately, that's the Christian life in a nutshell, isn't it? We go through battles, and God brings us blessings. Sometimes the blessing comes in the midst of the battle, sometimes before it, sometimes after. Sometimes the battle comes in the midst of the blessing. But ultimately, we have a choice. We're going to either complain, or we're going to be thankful. And Israel, well, they wanted to complain. Maybe you've been there. I know plenty of times I've been there. Well, not only that, but here's really kind of the meat of what we're going to look at today. Help. It happens after prayer. Because you know what? That's ultimately what we're going to see Moses do. So if you have your Bible with you today, let's look down and I'll read down at Exodus chapter 17 and let's read the rest of the narrative and then let's pull a few things out and see what God speaks to us today. The Bible says this, "Then Amalek came and fought with Israel at Rephidim. So Moses said to Joshua, 'Choose for us men and go out and fight with Amalek. Tomorrow I will stand on the top of the hill with the staff of God in my hand.' So Joshua did as Moses told him and fought with Amalek while Moses and Aaron and Hur went to the top of the hill." So we'll come back and kind of work through this text. I've still got our little rod with us today. Now make no mistake, this is just a illustration, if you will. This isn't actually the rod of God, especially for some of those kids out there. But this could be a great thing, like I said, kids, for you to draw a picture of. And we're going to see the picture's really going to start expanding now as we read through this text. But a couple of things that we need to probably be reminded of to understand kind of what's going on here. So first off, Israel is going to have no weapons. Remember, they left Egypt. They didn't have anything. In fact, they're wandering as nomads in the wilderness. If they had weapons, the only place they would have had a chance to get them was, guess what? From the Egyptians. And you guessed it, at the Red Sea. So they may have picked up a couple of weapons, but probably not enough for 3 to 5 million people, which is about how many people are here at this time. They may have had a few, but they weren't ready to fight, which is one of the reasons why, up to this point, they'd fought no battles. The last time we'd seen a war was Abraham back in Genesis, I believe it was 17 or 18. And so ultimately, Israel doesn't even know how to fight a war. They've lived in Egypt for 430 years. They had no reason to fight. Well, now they're going to get ready to fight a war, and very, very quickly. One other interesting note, the name Amalek means sinful. Now that's important because God is going to make a promise about the nation of Amalek and the fact that they need to be destroyed. They were evidently an extremely wicked nation, and they had not helped Israel. They were actually distant relatives of Israel, but they're going to become a thorn in their side for generations to come. And so it's interesting, a couple of other things that happen here. It's interesting, isn't it, that Moses chooses Joshua, which, by the way, means Yahweh or Jehovah is salvation. Now, we talked about Joshua last week, if you remember. Joshua pictures the Lord Jesus, as does Moses here. We're going to see a type of Christ. Interesting also that God makes war against this evil nation, Amalek. And 40 years later with Balaam in Numbers 24, they're still at war with Amalek, as they are in the book of 1 Samuel with King Saul. You might remember in 1 Samuel chapter 15, this is the very same nation where King Saul is told to completely destroy them. Remember King Agag? And Samuel comes and kills him because Saul doesn't want to do it. So this nation sticks a thorn in the side of Israel for a long time because ultimately Israel didn't completely obey God and finish them off as they were supposed to. David and his bandits will also kill a bunch of Amalekites at the end of 1 Samuel chapter 30. So I just tell you that to remind you that this nation, they're pretty prominent throughout the Old Testament, not just here in the book of Exodus chapter 17. And now, interestingly, as we go along, there's a couple of other things you'll want to note that I think are pretty interesting. Josephus, he's a Jewish writer, not a Christian, but a Jewish historian. He actually believes that Hur, a guy we're going to meet in just a moment, was actually Moses' brother-in-law, the husband of Miriam. Now, we have no biblical proof of that, but I found that interesting because we're going to find that Hur and Moses' brother Aaron are going to be a big help to Moses today. And so it would make sense that it was probably someone within Moses' family. If you want to read a passage that also reminds us of Israel's lack of good attitude here, you can go to Daniel chapter 9, verses 3 to 19. I read it earlier today, and wow, it is an awesome passage on repentance and the faithfulness of God and the lack of Israel trusting God. And although it doesn't reference this passage, you get the idea of what the heart issue was with Israel as they came in to this battle that God was about to win for them. By the way, Aaron means mountain of strength, and Hur means fire. And so that's kind of interesting, isn't it? Because we're going to see Aaron and Hur play a big part in this role now. So as you look, Moses has now told Joshua, we're going to go to war, and I've got the rod of God. Now, that's important because just like I hold this rod here, it wasn't so much about the rod, it was what the rod represents. So for those of you that partook with the Lord's table with us a few weeks ago, it's not about the grape juice, it's not about the crackers, it's about what they represent, right? The crackers represent Jesus' broken body. The grape juice represents his blood. It's not his body, it's not his blood. The rod was not God, but it was the rod of God that represented his power and his presence with his people. And that's going to be coming to play in a huge way in just a moment. So if you look, we stopped off in verse 10, and we're going to pick up in verse 11 now because things are really going to start picking up. Whenever Moses held up his hand, Israel prevailed, and whenever he lowered his hand, Amalek prevailed. So I want to stop there for just a moment. I want you to understand what's happening. Moses is up on the hill, and the battle is happening down in the valley. Now, as you read the text, you don't get the idea that Amalek attacked Israel just like that, immediately. There had to be a little bit of time for them to prepare, because the way the text is written, and Moses is the one writing this for us, I'm guessing they had a couple of hours. In fact, the area they were in had mountains all around it. And so most scholars believe that the folks from Amalek had probably been watching Israel for quite some time, but they were very concerned now. Why? Because Israel found water from a rock. Who doesn't want water from a rock? And water's obviously going to make a war because in Amalek's case, this was probably part of their land. And so they were going to take what was rightfully theirs. Now, God had made a special miracle out of that rock. That rock will again picture for us Christ, because Jesus Christ is our rock or our foundation. God does an incredible miracle. Amalek uses it as an opportunity to attack Israel. And so it's interesting now, Moses is holding up his hand, and every time he held it up, Israel prevailed, right? So think about it. If I picture Moses for a second, kids and adults, every time this rod is up, we win, but when I drop it, we lose. I mean, that must have been a pretty challenging thing for Moses especially. You know, he can see his fellow Israelites literally laying slain on the battlefield every time he drops his rod. You know, maybe somebody asks him a question. Hey, Moses, when are we going to get dinner? You know, and all of a sudden Moses drops it down to have a conversation like this and a bunch of people die. And so Moses has to keep the rod up because it represents God's presence. Now look at what the text says. When he had it up, they prevailed. When he lowered it, Amalek prevailed. But Moses' hands grew weary. Yeah, I would think so. This is a long day, right? I mean, if I stood here for the 35 minutes I'm going to preach or so, I could probably hold this up. But I bet after 15 or so, I would be pretty tired. And I can't imagine doing it all day. And so the Bible says that Moses' hands grew weary, so they took a stone and put it under him, and he sat on it. Now, it's an interesting note as I was reading through this text that I think is one of the reasons why context is so important. If you look back at Exodus chapter 17 and verse 4, the Bible will say, "So Moses cried to the Lord." Now that's important because ultimately what that essentially is Moses is praying to God. And so I think here one of the things we need to understand is as Moses is using the rod and it is representing the presence of God, also one of the reasons Moses' hands were up is typically a Jewish idea of prayer, which is either of hands raised or prostrating oneself on the ground. And so many scholars believe that Moses is literally pleading out this entire time or praying. And so now you have the idea again of Moses being seated on a rock with something holding his hands up, a couple of rocks. And so you get the idea of Moses like this. Now, I don't know if all of you can see this or not, but I'll do my best. But if you do get the idea of a couple of rocks like this and hands like this, do you have any idea what that looks just a little bit like? Looks a little bit like a cross, doesn't it? Now, the text of Scripture doesn't necessarily tell us that. But I think that there's no doubt about it, that there's probably a picture here that we would know from the New Testament looking back. Would Israel have picked up on it? Probably not. But we sure would. And I think we're probably meant to. Now we'll leave that where it is for now, but it's interesting all of the different intricacies of the text that can come out as you read through it. Now here's one thing that I thought was pretty neat. As you come to this point now, Moses, he's obviously beat. He can't hold the rod up anymore. His hands are being held up by rocks. And this is where I think some application that's going to get pretty serious for us in a really positive way comes out. Look at what the text says. Moses needs some help. And it says, while he sat on it, while Aaron and Hur held his hands up, one on one side and the other on the other side, so his hands were steady until the going down of the sun. So can you imagine Moses seated there? His hands are up like this. It's sort of a prayerful position. Whether he was literally praying or not, we don't know. But the idea surely seems to be there. And his hands were so heavy that now Aaron and Hur, by the way, Aaron's name meaning mountain of strength and Hur being fire, are right next to him and they are holding his hands up. So Moses needed Aaron and Hur. So do we, don't we? You need an Aaron and you need a Hur. Or maybe you need to be Aaron or Hur. And we'll come back to that in just a moment. Let's finish what the text says, though. Remember, Moses is being propped up by Aaron and Hur. They're helping him. They're prevailing. Moses is in sort of this attitude. It almost seems a prayer. You get the idea of the cross in some ways, right? Or at least we do. I don't know that they did. Many think Moses is persistently praying, and thus God gives the victory back from chapter 17 and verse 4. And so it's interesting now, one other thing to note. We'll come back to it, but it says, and Joshua overwhelmed Amalek and his people with the sword. Now remember what Joshua means. Jehovah is salvation. You know the name Joshua, right? Yeshua, the Savior, Jesus, Joshua, Christ, the King. Jesus and Joshua have the same name, ultimately. Different languages, but the same name. So Joshua, no doubt, is a picture of Christ. So is Moses. They're not Christ, just like the rod is not God. But they're a picture of Christ. Now remember what incredible things God had done here, right? He'd done miracle after miracle for Israel. 10 plagues in Egypt. He'd brought them through the Red Sea. He'd brought them water out of places that were bitter. He now brought water out of a rock. And they were still complaining, asking, is God among us? And now Moses, their leader, is literally crying to God for them back in 17:4, saying, look, I can't handle these people. They're going to kill me. And now Aaron and Hur have come. They've held Moses up because Moses could not do this by himself. You know, no matter how long the social distancing goes, you and I need to remember, you were not meant to live life by yourself. You were meant to be part of a community. You were meant to be part of the body of Christ. And friends, there will come a day. There'll come a day when we worship in this church again, where we're able to see each other face to face. There'll also come a day when we see our Savior face to face. Amen? That's going to be a great day. But here in this text, we're reminded of the fact that the time hadn't come yet. Moses was not meant to do this himself. Even the great Moses, up to this point, there had not been a time really where he needed a lot of help. He'd pretty much done most of it by himself. Aaron was kind of his sidekick and would use the staff or the rod of God, but Moses did things mostly by himself. But even the great Moses here needed Aaron and Hur to help him. In fact, in chapter 18, his father-in-law is going to come, and Moses is going to realize he needs even more help. Now, if Moses, probably, arguably, the greatest prophet in the Old Testament, wasn't supposed to do things by himself, you think there's any application there for you and me? Oh, you better believe it, right? Well, before we get to the application, though, one more thought that Moses is going to pen for us. The Holy Spirit has inspired it. That's a great reminder for each of us. Look at the last couple of verses. Then the Lord said to Moses, write this as a memorial in a book and recite it in the ears of Joshua, that I will utterly blot out the memory of Amalek from under heaven. And Moses built an altar and called the name of it, the Lord is my banner, saying, a hand upon the throne of the Lord. The Lord will have war with Amalek from generation to generation. So God makes a promise here. He eventually wipes out Amalek. Now, because Israel didn't do it here, they are going to become a thorn in Israel's side. In the book of Judges, especially in the books of 1 and 2 Samuel, you might remember King Saul. He had his chance. He blew it. He was supposed to wipe out the nation of Amalek. He didn't do it. They come back, and they're a thorn in the side of David and in Israel for a long, long time. Okay, but God, he's a faithful God, and he always does what he says. He keeps his covenant. He keeps his promises. But I want to focus in on that little phrase there. The Lord is my banner. That might sound familiar to some of you. It should. That's a phrase that's used quite a few times in the Bible. This one does not get the most play, although maybe it should. The one that's probably most well known is out of the book of Song of Solomon. Chapter 2 and verse 4. Solomon is bringing his new wife in, they're finally married, and the Bible says, he brought me into the banqueting house, and his banner over me was love. We sing a song, right? His banner over me is love, right? And that comes out of that marriage between Solomon and this young lady. Well, I would submit to you that I think this particular passage here maybe has a little more force than that one does, but it might remind you of that. It's not the only one. In the book of Isaiah chapter 11, verse 10, it says, in that day there shall be a root of Jesse, talking about the Lord Jesus, who shall stand as a banner to the people. In Isaiah 31, 9, he shall cross over his stronghold, and his princes shall be afraid of the banner. Zechariah 9:16 says, for the Lord their God will save them in that day as the flock to his people, for they shall be like the jewels of a crown lifted like a banner over his land. Now you might wonder, why do I keep lifting the rod? Well, I don't know what comes to your mind when you think of a banner. What comes to mind is something like a flag or a banner that communicates something. But in this context here, I think it's pretty obvious that Moses' banner was his staff. A banner doesn't just have to be a piece of cloth. It can be an object. And so in context, it's pretty obvious that the banner Moses is talking about is his staff. And so ultimately, what he's saying is, look, I don't need that. This isn't God's presence. Moses wasn't God's presence. The Lord was his banner. Maybe you're discouraged. Maybe you're fearful and frightened. Friend, the Lord is your banner. Or if you don't know him, he desires to be your banner. He desires to be the one who you hold up, the one who covers you, the one who protects you, the one who leads and guides you, just like he did with Israel. Well, let's bring this to a close. What would be some ways that we could apply a text like this to our lives? Oh, my friends, there are many. There are many ways. So let's review. What did we look at? Well, complaining and thankfulness. Do we complain or are we thankful? Help. I need help. How about you? We're not meant to do this alone. We all need to be Aaron and Hur. So let me give you some to-do list things that you can think about this week. First off, in the same way that God has shown his presence with Israel, he continued to do so with Moses and then also with Joshua. In fact, we looked at that last week with Joshua, didn't we? Where God says, be strong and courageous because of days like this that Joshua lived through. That Moses stood there and he needed help from Aaron and Hur. The rod of God is God's presence with his people. This was a reminder of God's presence with his people. You know, friends, we have a great reminder of God's presence with his people. The Word of God. We have the living Word of God that is a great reminder of God's presence with us. What an incredible thing. What an awesome thing. So let me ask you a question. Are you thankful or do you just need to complain? Now, if I'm honest, I'll tell you, I think I complain more than I should. I'm not as thankful as I should be. The Apostle Paul will tell us in 1 Thessalonians 5 to be thankful in everything. I mean, how do you be thankful when you're going through a pandemic? How do you be thankful when you lose a loved one? How are you thankful when you lose your job? Well, friends, I don't know that specific circumstances always cause us to be thankful. But I know this, the God who allows the circumstances, we can always rejoice in him. We can be thankful that he's in control, that he's on the throne. Another question for you. Are you trusting in yourself or trusting in the Lord? Now see, even Moses here needed to be reminded that his trust needed to not be in the rod, but in the God who gave him the rod. And finally, one other thing I'd like to ask you, or a couple more, is who's your Aaron and Hur? Now I'm not Moses, nor could I ever be. But if I pictured him for us today a little bit, I need Aaron and Hur to do the things I have to do. For instance, most of you today have no idea all the things going on behind the scenes, but I can't do this without Pastor Giuliani. There's just no way. And we can't do it without a camera and a computer screen and notes and different things here. And so in the same way that I can't do all the things that I'm doing today without him, you know what? I can't do them without you. I need an Aaron and a Hur sometimes to hold my hands up. As a pastor, as a Christian, as a father. But you know, then there's times in my life when I need to be Aaron and Hur to someone else who's Moses. And you know, friends, I want to encourage you, and this is where I think the rubber meets the road, that there are a lot of people that are probably dealing with life maybe a little bit like how Moses was here. Now, we're not ripping on Moses. I don't think this is a passage about Moses' badness or something he did wrong. No, this is a passage about God's power and authority, and the reminder that even one of the godliest men that ever lived, God will comment on Moses, one of the most humble men that ever lived. God spoke with him face to face. Even Moses needed help. And you know what? So do you and I. We need help. And so who could you be Aaron and Hur to this week? Who can you hold up their arms? Now, maybe not physically, obviously, like with Moses here, but could you write somebody a card? Could you send them an email? What about making a phone call? Maybe it's even someone you could make a meal for. I don't know. Maybe those of you that are going out grocery shopping, you can go shopping for somebody maybe who's a widow, or they're laid up and they can't get out of the house, or maybe their immunity's not good. They have a low immunity, and so they can't get out. And this coronavirus is really, really dangerous for them. And so you could be Aaron and Hur holding their hands up by doing something they can't do. Maybe it's going shopping, picking up their mail. I don't know. But what I do know is many of us need to be reminded that even in times like this, God has a purpose for us, and we need to be here to help each other. Two verses that I'd like to close with. One is in the book of Ecclesiastes, and one's in the book of Romans. Ecclesiastes 4:12 says this, though one may be overpowered by another, two can withstand him, and a threefold cord is not quickly broken. You know what, friends? We were not made to live this life alone. If we didn't know it before, the pandemic has sure taught us, hasn't it? We need each other. Even those of you that consider yourself introverts, I think finally, maybe some of you are learning, you know what, I might be introverted, but I need people. Yeah, some of us are extroverts, some are introverts, but we all need people. We were made in God's image and likeness. We were made to have a relationship with others. And a three-fold cord is not easily broken. In other words, Ecclesiastes will tell us that two is better than one. We need each other. Romans 14:19 will tell us this. Therefore, let us pursue the things which make for peace and the things by which we may edify one another. Now, that's Aaron and Hur. You know, there's probably a lot of things they could have been doing that day. They could have been down fighting the battle. Maybe they had other things to do. I mean, remember, Aaron is the high priest, or he's going to become the high priest pretty quickly. I mean, he had a pretty high position, and yet he's there helping Moses. Wow. And yet he had to serve. Friends, none of us is above anybody else. And so this week, I want to encourage you, be an Aaron or be a Hur to someone else who's Moses. Step outside yourself. Paul in the book of Philippians will remind us to consider others more important than ourselves. And you know what? At the end of the day, if the pandemic's taught me anything, and it's taught me a lot of things, but one of the things that keeps running through my mind is this. You know what? I don't really have a hard time taking care of myself. I care about myself. I love myself. Probably too much sometimes. But at the end of the day, it's reminded me that there are a lot of people around me that need to know that God loves them and that he cares for them and that I need to be like Aaron and Hur and help them. So let me encourage you this week. Step outside of your comfort zone. Talk to somebody else. Be a little bit different. Let me close with this. I actually got this from an Aaron and Hur moment. We were on a senior trip down in New Jersey, and I hurt myself in the ocean where I was walking with a pretty good limp. And so the senior class of LFCA, our Christian Academy here, saw fit to buy me this, partially as a joke and partially to help me out. And 14 years later, I've still got it. And I used it, and it was a big help because I was pretty much hobbling along for quite some time. And every time I look at it, I've always thought of this passage of Scripture, that class that week was Aaron and Hur to me. Now to them, whether they meant it as just a fun thing or actually to help me out or not, I think it was a little bit of both, but it was a blessing. And you know what? We are called to be a blessing to others. So you be a blessing this week to someone else around you, in your family, your friends, and ask God to help you and how you might do that. One final note. If you're listening today and you don't know Christ, and you don't know the things we talk about, friend, come to salvation today. Understand that it's not about the rod of God. It's not about me. It's not about this video. It's about a God who loves you, sent his son Jesus to pay the penalty on the cross for your sins. His son really died. We celebrated his resurrection a few weeks ago, and he's coming back. And the Bible says today is the day of salvation. And so I encourage you to trust in Christ today. For the rest of us, let's pray and let's go put this into practice this week, being Aaron and Hur to those that are around us. Let's pray. Father, thank you again for your faithfulness through your word, that you are a loving God, you are a just God, you are a jealous and holy God. And you remind us through passages like this how incredibly powerful you are and how you care for us and you love us. I pray this week, Lord, that we would turn that around and be an Aaron and a Hur to someone that we come into contact with. Lord, maybe we're shopping in the grocery store and somebody's in front of us and they can't pay their bill. Or maybe this week we think of someone who we haven't heard from in a while and we drop a note in the mail or give them a phone call. But Lord, help us to consider how we might be an example to others. And as Paul says in Romans 14, that we might edify one another, we might lift each other up. We love you and thank you for this time. In Jesus' precious and holy name, amen.